The last speech is entitled The Life of Hazrat Chaudhary Muhammad Zafarulla Khan Sahib, Razallahu Anhu, which will be delivered by Mr. Rafiq Ahmad Hayat Sahib, Amir of UK.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.
Respected Chairman, all the participants of this Jalsa Salana, the topic that I have been given today is the life of Hazrat Chaudhary Sir Muhammad Zafarulla Khan Sahib. It was once said by Albert Einstein, do not to become a man of success, but rather to become a man of value. Hazrat Chaudhary Sir Muhammad Zafarulla Khan Sahib was truly a man of value, but Allah also blessed him with success and worldwide fame. When I was asked to speak on the life of Chaudhary Sahib, I assumed this would be an easy task, as I had known him personally and spent time in his company, and also his life is well documented. How wrong was I? Chaudhary Sahib is not the name of an ordinary man. He's after all a legend, and his achievements are legendary too. When I started looking into his life in detail, I realized that it is impossible to encapsulate all his achievements in a half-hour speech. He wrote the history of Pakistan by his service and his deeds. His service to humanity and his advocacy for the freedom of Kashmir and other Islamic countries are considered as milestones in the 20th century history of the world. Personally, I got to know Chaudhary Sahib when my family and I migrated from East Africa to England in the 1960s. I was a young man, and Chaudhary Sahib used to come to London from Holland over the weekends. He used to take great interest in the training and education of youngsters. He started the Quran classes in London Mosque and later on formed the study circles, which became very popular amongst the youth. From my own experience, I can say that Chaudhary Sahib had a great influence on me and shaped my values, which proved to be invaluable over the years. He taught us to live a simple and moral life with humility, modesty, and care towards other people, with great emphasis on punctuality. He taught us these values not only in his lectures, but everyday conduct in which he followed these traits without fail. He was a simple person himself and liked simple people. I remember when he appointed my father as one of the directors of the trust that he created to help students with their studies. My father expressed reservations regarding his qualification, and Chaudhary Sahib simply replied, "You are an honest man and a humble man, two qualities that are better than any qualification. You will soon learn." Chaudhary Sahib had a very unassuming nature, and after his retirement, he was once admitted into hospital for a checkup. The senior nurse who was looking after him asked Anwar Kalu Sahib, who was accompanying him, if the elderly gentleman spoke English. And Chaudhary Sahib responded himself and said, "A little." Later on, when she went to check on him, she found Chaudhary Sahib busy editing various books in English, of which three of the books had been completed. She then realized that this was no ordinary person. And when she found out the truth, she was so upset with Kalu Sahib for not informing her of his high status that she told him off. His selfless nature was reflected in the personal sacrifices he made to save money for the benefit of others. I remember he used to get off the train at Putney Bridge Station, two stations before Southfields, and he used to tell us that the tuppence that he saved would help to educate a young student in Pakistan. His generosity was widely spread, even at the cost of his own expenses. Such was the man that I knew. With all the honors heaped on him by the world, he acted in the most humble manner and never imposed his status on his subordinates or juniors. He expressed his feelings in a letter to one of his admirers in these words: If I could believe myself truly deserving one of the 100th portion of the encomia that the generosity of your heart has persuaded you to heap on me, I would deem myself most fortunate. Yet I must humbly acknowledge with deep gratitude that the countless bounties that Allah, the Lord of immense grace, have bestowed upon me throughout my life, unworthy as I know myself to be. Chaudhary Sahib was born in 1983 in Sialkot, in what became one of the earliest Ahmadi households in the district. Son of a practicing lawyer, he himself rose to one of the shrewdest legal minds in his time. He was also greatly devoted to his mother. As a child, he accompanied his mother on a trip to visit the promised Messiah, al-Islam, in Sialkot. Chaudhary Sahib's mother was moved by the message and the truth of the promised Messiah, al-Islam, and decided to take bath at his hand. At that time, Chaudhary Sahib was too young himself to take bath, and he remained deeply attached to the promised Messiah, al-Islam, for a number of years. He finally took his bath at the hand of the promised Messiah in the last year before the bath register was closed. Chaudhary Sahib's extraordinary love and devotion to his mother is evident when he writes exclusively about her in a book called My Mother. After the demise of the promised Messiah, al-Islam, Chaudhary Sahib showed his unmatched devotion to the institution of Khilafat and served 4 Khalifas in his time with absolute obedience and devotion. At the very height of his career, he never undertook any mission without the blessing and the prayers of the Khulafas. As an active Ahmadi Muslim, he was the Amir of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community in Lahore during the period 1919 to 1935. He served as a secretary to Khalifatul Masih II at the occasion of Shura for the first time in 1924 and continued in that capacity for a number of years. Chaudhary Sahib's devotion to the Jama'at and his invaluable contributions can be a subject for another occasion, as it may require many hours to recount. He was a member of a delegation which represented the Ahmadiyya Muslim community at the All Peace Conference held in 1924. And in 1927, he acted successfully as a representative counsel for the Muslims of Punjab in the contempt of court case against the Muslim Outlook. However, today, I would like to focus on his illustrious public career in the service of the state of Pakistan and his logical and forceful advocacy for the cause of the Arabs in particular, and his support to the aspirations of subject nations of Africa and the Third World. On the forum of United Nations and outside that won him universal appreciation and respect. His early education was in Sialkot, after which he proceeded to Lahore for his bachelor's degree under the tutelage of none other than the great Allama Iqbal himself. He got his law degree from King's College in London in 1914, where he stood top of his class and was the first person from the Indian subcontinent to do so. He was, like most great figures of the time, called to the bar at Lincoln's Inn and subsequently practiced law in the Lahore High Court from 1914 to 1935. From 1926 to 1935, he was a member of the Punjab Legislative Council. And during this period, from 1930 to 32, he also served as a delegate to the Indian Roundtable Conference. He was the elected president of All India Muslim League in 1931, and in 1933, he served as a delegate to the Joint Select Committee of Parliament on Indian Reform. From 1935 to 41, he was a member of the Viceroy's Executive Council, holding the portfolio of Commerce and Railways, Industry and Labour, and Law and War Supplies. In December 1939, Chaudhary Sahib headed the Indian delegation to the session of the Assembly of the Leagues of Nations, and from October 1941 to June 1947, he served as a judge of the Federal Court of India. During this period, he served briefly during 1942 in China as the Agent General of the Government of India. Chaudhary Sahib was appointed by Qaid-e-Azam as the advocate for the All India Muslim League to argue their case before the Redcliffe Commission for the partition of Punjab. And as a result, his vigorous advocacy of the Muslim League case before the Redcliffe Commission, the Urdu Daily Nawaye Waqt Lahore, dated the 1st of August 1947, writes, "For 4 days on end, Chaudhary Muhammad Zafarulla Khan argued the Muslim case in the most forceful, most brilliant, and most reasonable manner. Success is in the hand of Providence, but the excellence and the ability with which Zafarulla Khan advocated the Muslim case has given satisfaction to the Muslims in as much as they feel that their just and righteous cause has been represented before the powers to be. We are confident that the Muslims of Punjab, whatever their religious beliefs, would acknowledge and be grateful for this service." After 1953 disturbances against the Ahmadis, a court of inquiry was set up by the government of Punjab, presided by Justice Muhammad Munir, a judge of the Lahore court, who later rose to the office of the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Pakistan. And he writes in his report, commonly referred to as the Munir Report, "The president of this court, who was a member of the commission, considered it his duty to record his gratitude to Chaudhary Zafarulla Khan for the valiant fight he put up for Gurdaspur. This is apparent from the record of the Boundary Commission, which anyone who's interested to see, for the selfless service rendered by him to the Muslim community. It is shameless ingratitude for anyone to refer to Chaudhary Zafarulla Khan in a manner which has been referred to by certain parties before the Court of Inquiry." Following the independence of Pakistan in 1947, Chaudhary Sahib became Pakistan's Minister for Foreign Affairs and Commonwealth Relations. And in that capacity, until 1954, headed Pakistan's delegation to the United Nations General Assembly sessions, and also to the Security Council meetings on the India-Pakistan dispute during 1948 to 1952. It was Chaudhary Sahib whose effort materialized into the United Nations resolution on Kashmir. His speech on the Kashmir issue on January the 15th, 1948, in the United Nations Security Council is considered as the most comprehensive presentation of the Kashmir issue ever on the international stage. His speech continued for 7 straight hours and resulted in the United Nations resolution on Kashmir, which Pakistan even today holds as evidence and basis for its case for Kashmir. Chaudhary Muhammad Ali, who was the foreign minister in 1951 and the prime minister of Pakistan in 1955, were referring to the debate on Kashmir in the Security Council and Pakistan's reply on the 15th of January 1948 to India's complaint in his monumental book, The Emergence of Pakistan, states that Zafarullah Khan's masterly exposition on the case convinced the Security Council that the problem was simply not one of expelling the so-called raiders from Kashmir, as the Indian representative would have them believe, but of placing Indo-Pakistan relation on a just and peaceful basis and solving the Kashmir dispute in accordance with the will of the people of the state. At the United Nations in 1947, Chaudhary Saab took up the cause of Muslims generally and Palestinians particularly. He emerged as the most eloquent advocate of the Third World and Islamic issues. Zafarullah Khan was a great orator for the Palestinian and the Arab cause and was an extremely respected figure in the Muslim world. He raised the Palestinian issue in the United Nations on multiple occasions. In October 1947, he delivered a speech on the Palestinian issue at the UN General Assembly, which is one of the strongest cases ever presented for the Palestinians to date. After his speech, the statement of a newspaper in Delhi writes, "For the first time, the voice of Pakistan was heard in the Council of the United Nations on a burning topic of worldwide significance when the leader of this country's delegation, Chaudhary Zafarullah Khan, addressed the United Nations Palestinian Committee at Lake Success on Tuesday. It was a telling speech which tore into shreds the precious pleas forwarded by the advocates of partition of Palestine. We have little doubt that the Arabs will rejoice to find the voice of Pakistan so powerfully raised in the United Nations in the defense of their cause. The addition of the independent sovereign state of Pakistan to the Committee of the Free Muslim Peoples of the World is already beginning to have its effect on international affairs. King Faisal Al Saud, who in his capacity as the Foreign Minister of Saudi Arabia headed the Saudi Arabian delegation to the United Nations, in a letter dated the 5th of May, wrote to Chaudhary Saab and thanked him and said, for your close cooperation with the noble stand with which Your Excellency has taken not only during the meeting, but since the question of Palestine has been put before the United Nations, allow me to state that your high principles have created a desire on the part of all righteous people to identify themselves with the efforts of Your Excellency, not only on the behalf of the Arabs, but Muslims all over the world. The Secretary General of the Arab League, Abdul Rahman Azim Pasha, in his letter of the November 1951, said, reading your speech in the United Nations Assembly, I prayed to God to save you and preserve your health in the service of Islam. Al-Ayyam of Damascus, in the issue of the 24th of February, writes, Zafarullah Khan will be given a tremendous welcome in the Syrian capital. He raised his voice in the defense of humanity, justice, and righteousness at every political gathering and at every international forum. His conscience is saturated with faith. His conversation is marked with reason and logic. He always keeps in view true and unalloyed good of humanity. In welcoming Muhammad Zafarullah Khan today, we are welcoming a person of faith, belief, and humanness. A prominent Egyptian leader, Al-Said Mustafa Momin, in an interview to the APP, which was published on the 24th of May, 1952, states, Chaudhary Muhammad Zafarullah Khan holds an enviable position in the world of Islam. is looked upon as the topmost statement in the Middle East in general, and in Egypt and other Arab countries in particular. By his forceful support of Tunisia, Morocco, Iran, and Egypt in the United Nations, he has served the cause of Islam in a way no other world leader has been able to do. In June in 1952, Al Jazeera, a Cairo newspaper, carried a so-called fatwa by Mufti Hussein Muhammad Mahlouf, in which he had attacked the Ahmadiyya Jama'at and in process used shameful words for Chaudhary Sahib. The General Secretary of the Arab League, Abdul Rahman Azim Pasha, issued a statement expressing extreme disgust over the fatwa. The statement by the General Secretary was also published by the Al Jazeera, and it's read, "It came to me a great surprise that you, i.e. the editor of the newspaper, accepted an opinion expressed by Mufti about Qadianis or Chaudhary Muhammad Zafarullah Khan as an effective religious fatwa. If this principle is accepted, the belief of human beings and their honor and prestige and their entire future will be at the mercy of the views and opinions of a few ulama." It was not only Palestine, but Libya, Morocco, Tunisia, and other Muslim countries for which Chaudhary Sahib spoke in the United Nations. He was a fearless and frank spokesman for the rights of Muslims. In 1954, Chaudhary Sahib was elected a member of the International Court of Justice at The Hague, and served in that capacity until February 1961, during which period he became the Vice President of the World Court. Later, he became the first Asian President of the International Court of Justice, and a singular, unique honor for any Pakistani. He also served briefly as the President of the United General Assembly, and on his retirement from the International Court of Justice at The Hague, the former Prime Minister of Pakistan, Zulfikar Ali Bhutto, sent him a message which read, "I wish to convey to you our deep appreciation for the services that you have selflessly rendered over several decades to the people of Pakistan as well as to the international community. As a leading member of political movement, we pledge the achievement of the homeland for all Muslims in the subcontinent, and earlier as the president of the All India Muslim League in 1931, you played a very significant role in the creation of Pakistan. As foreign minister for Pakistan, for the first 7 years after the birth of the country, you helped in establishing Pakistan as a state which commanded respect abroad and whose voice carried weight in international forums. As the President of the UN General Assembly and as a judge of the International Court of Justice, you will not only serve the international community as a whole, but in doing so, enhance the prestige of Pakistan. I can say with full confidence that all of us share the pride that one naturally felt and the respect that you commanded in the international community. Sayyid Sharifuddin Pirzada, a former foreign minister of Pakistan and a well-known law practitioner of Pakistan, also said, "From Sialkot to the Security Council, from the Roundtable Conference to the International Conference, from the Joint Parliamentary Committee on Constitutional Reform to the Constituent Assembly of Pakistan, from Viceroy's Executive Council to the Pakistani Cabinet, from the Indian Assembly to the General Assembly of the United Nations, and from the Federal Court of the Subcontinent to the International Court of Justice, Chaudhary Sahib's contribution is clean, consistent, credible, commendable." Chaudhary Sahib came from a very noble family, and he never aspired to any political power or social eminence. He was a diplomat forced to become a politician and moved among the community of nations. As a judge at the highest level, he dispensed justice. Chaudhary Sahib was also able to debate with some of the great minds of his time, including Churchill, Mountbatten, Truman, the Kennedys, Nehru, Gandhi, Prince Saud, all of whom had a great influence on history. This is the contribution Chaudhary Sahib helped to write some of this history. What sort of a person was he? He came from a noble family, and although his stature in the world was unmistakably evident, he never aspired to any political power or social eminence. In his private life, his whole being was anchored in the love of God. Because of the shortage of time, I am going to miss some part of the Chaudhary Muhammad Zafarullah Khan, the giant personality in the international history, the proud son of Pakistan, a confident colleague of Qaid-e-Azam, who had the honor to be the first foreign minister of Pakistan, passed away on the 1st of September 1985 at the age of 93. May his soul rest in peace. He was indeed a true Muslim, devoted and saturated to the love of God. His love of God and the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is evident in his translation of the Holy Quran, that is perhaps the most articulate translation available. He has also written a beautiful biography of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, titled Muhammad, the Seal of Prophets. He's an author of many books, including Islam and Human Rights, that is one of the most appreciated books on human rights. Islam, Its Meaning for Modern Man, The Agony of Pakistan, and My Mother, amongst many other books that he wrote. An international jurist, one of the sharpest minds of his time, an Arabic scholar, a diplomat, an acknowledged scholar, and an author. Indeed, he was a polymath in the true traditions of early Islamic period. A famous analyst, critic, and historian of Pakistan, Riz Ahmed Jafri, wrote in his journal, The Riaz, in November 1954, as the foreign minister of Pakistan, Chaudhary Sahib's contribution is invaluable. At a difficult and sensitive juncture in the history of Pakistan, he served with great oratory, force, and argument, and legal reasoning that even his enemies were forced to admire him. Chaudhary Sahib possesses great personal qualities. He belongs to a sect which is generally considered as kafirs, but this kafir is not shy of having a beard, and even in the meetings of United Nations, he does not hesitate to perform his regular prayers. When the famous train collision occurred in Pakistan in the 1950s, in the early hours in which he was traveling, he was busy saying his Fajr prayers. On the 6th of February 2011, marked the 118th birthday of the Pakistan's great unsung hero. Once again, there was no mention or commemoration of his remarkable contribution, no sense of gratitude from the nation from which he did so much. He has been wiped out of Pakistan's memory because he was an Ahmadi, despite his glorious contributions to Pakistan and his cause. Professor K.K. Aziz, the only true historian produced by Pakistan, said, Chaudhary Sahib, that all his life he served his country with single-minded devotion and in an upright and principled way. He served the movement that led to the establishment of Pakistan. And while we, the Pakistani Muslims, excommunicated him from our religion, we should not excommunicate him from our memories too, because nations which forget their great men ultimately stop producing them. We see the pygmies of today with begging bowls in their hands, and we can realize the truth of the above statement. May Allah grant Chaudhary Sahib lofty status in paradise, and may Allah enable the young minds of our Jama'at to follow in his footsteps. Ameen. Jazakallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Nara takbir! Nara takbir! Islam Ahmadiyyat!
Zindabad!
Islam Ahmadiyyat!
Zindabad!
Insaniyat! Insaniyat!
Zindabad!
Nara takbir!
Allahu Akbar! Jazakallahu khairan!